Focus of attention for Cygnus after its launch from the Mid-Atlantic Regional Spaceport there at Wallops Flight Facility on the eastern shore of Virginia. After it was safely delivered to orbit, switched to the Cygnus Control Center, which is at Orbital Sciences headquarters there outside Washington, D.C. In the Dulles, Virginia area. And we're fortunate to have Bruce Manners with us, joining us from Dulles, from the Orbital location. He's the project executive for NASA's Commercial Orbital Transportation Services Program. And Bruce, are you there? It's great to have you with us today.
Yes, I am. I'm really glad to be here.
I bet you are. I tell you, the I was on console for the launch, and you know, the Antares obviously did its job putting Cygnus into orbit, and I guess that just started the work day for all the Orbital folks and the NASA folks that are supporting there at Dulles.
Yes, it did. It was a beautiful launch. I was actually privileged to be at the Range Control Center at Wallops for the launch and was able to see that and the data launch, the data and all that firsthand. And it was just an exciting moment. But as you said, it was really just the beginning. Once the Antares rocket left the spacecraft on orbit, focus really shifted over here to Dulles in Virginia, where the flight control team for the Cygnus spacecraft took over.
And I've been reporting each day a little bit about the progress and the health of the spacecraft, but maybe you can go into some more detail, I guess, about after we went off the air Wednesday. Obviously, the solar arrays were out, the vehicle was healthy, but talk about what's kind of been the progress since Wednesday and set the stage for Sunday.
Sure. Well, the vehicle is in great shape. I really couldn't be happier with how things are operating there. They have, at this point, completed the first of their, a couple of their demonstration objectives that they need to accomplish before they get approved to come into the station. That data right now is really still in review with all of the flight control teams back with in Houston and in Dulles. But the preliminary looks at all the data says that everything's going great. They were able to maintain position and attitude control and free drift when told to and when commanded to. So that's all great news. What's really been happening since then, they have the solar arrays out and the spacecraft is fully powered. They've checked out all the systems and everything seems to be running really great. So really the big movements right now is just chasing after the space station, doing Delta V burns and trying to get themselves into the proper position to once they get the authorization from Houston to come into the station. So that's really been the focus of the activities, checking out that vehicle, getting those first couple of demonstrations done, and chasing the station.
So so that leads us to Sunday morning, obviously, for the rendezvous. Everything starts happening about 1:30 in the morning, I guess, your time there on Eastern time, 12:30 here. But one of the first call-outs, I guess, that morning is the go-no-go decision for joint operations. And then from there on, kind of the rest of the it's a pretty feverish pace, I guess, in orbital mechanics lingo. But describe to us kind of what's going to happen on Sunday.
I'll do the best I can. I've got really the best one for all the orbital mechanics pieces of it. The mission flight teams are, I'm sure, much more equipped to handle those kinds of questions. But as they come into the station, they will have some demonstration pieces that they need to sort out until they can get close enough and ultimately captured by the robotic arm. It will be operated, of course, by the onboard crew and the International Space Station. That capture point, once they've been able to grab a hold of them, that's referred to as capture, and then they will berth them all the way into the space station, where then the we've got pieces then that the crew will have to bolt the vehicle into the space station before they'll be able to ultimately open the hatch, which will hopefully happen in a day or so after that.
In this flight, it's called a demo flight, but obviously with everything going very smoothly, I mean, all the orbital folks, NASA, obviously you guys have to be really thrilled with the performance of this vehicle so far. But now you look to the next flight, which I guess is known essentially as the real first cargo delivery flight. But and I understand preparations are probably already underway to reach a goal of trying to launch that flight maybe as early as December.
Yes, sir. They do have cargo on this flight. There is a little over 700 kilograms of cargo on this flight. But the intent here was to keep that really sort of low-value pieces just in case there was any issues. But right now, of course, it looks like we are absolutely on track to be able to deliver that cargo to the station. And it has some student payloads and then some, pieces for the crew themselves and things, all that. But there is work well underway for the first operational flight under the CRS contract. We do hope that can possibly happen in December, maybe not until January. That schedule needs to get sorted out at this point. But if you were to go to the horizontal integration facility at Wallops, you will see all the pieces really coming together for the next Antares. And in H-100 at Wallops, they also have the next PCM, the pressurized cargo module, the service modules. It's all really starting to come together. And you can see the pieces, and the crank is beginning to turn to really see it in a production line mode so they can keep churning these things out every 6 months or so. But we are really excited about this mission right now. But if you look in the history where we are, this is really you could think of it as the third flight of Antares in the last 7 or 8 months. They had a hot fire test that was done back early this year. And, of course, the Antares flight in April, and then this flight with Antares and Cygnus again now, they've really done an awful lot. But you can see that the production line mentality is setting in, and so they can churn those things out and get them out as quickly and as often as we need them.
Yeah, that sounds great. It's it's nice to have a vehicle that is probably well ahead of its processing, and all it has to do is wait for a little bit of highway traffic around the station, and it's always nice to have a busy highway around the ISS.
Absolutely. When we get this mission, we will deliver the cargo up there. We'll take some trash away when they leave in 30 days. And then, as you said, they're rapidly trying to get everything wrapped up and buttoned up for the next mission, which hopefully we can do as early as December, but if not, maybe into January. But the hardware is definitely coming together.
Well, obviously, give all of our best to the Orbital team and obviously the NASA folks supporting all the activities up there at Dulles. Will obviously be here supporting as well and watching along. And we really appreciate you, Bruce, stopping by and talking with us today.
Thank you very much, and you folks have a great day, and let's go Cygnus. Looking forward to the birthday on Sunday.
Take care. Thanks, Bruce.
Thank you.